Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for being here. My name is Horacio De Leon. I am with the City of Laredo City Manager's Office, and it's exciting to see all of you here today, especially after the last 2 weeks of input that we've had on the comprehensive plan. I'd like to recognize the presence of Councilmember Valle. Robert Roberto Valle is here with us today. And also all the city staff that are here also representing the City of Laredo. At this time, I'd like to introduce our mayor for the city, Mr. Pete Sainz, who will be doing a welcome. Thank you.
Good evening. Okay. Now it's really working. Thank you so much for being here with us. It's been 2 weeks now, two, 3 weeks, I think, that we have received input from all of you all. And I can see that there's a wide variety of walks of life here of our great city. I am told that the participation is even greater, three times greater than
my understanding that we've had three times the participation here in Laredo, Texas, as compared to El Paso. And of course, El Paso is a million or more people. So Laredo, thank you. We can sense the momentum. We all knew that we needed a comprehensive master plan. So we got the architects, Frank Ravnostic and this group, and Peña, the architect, and of course all the other associates, and it's all for you. Our city is changing, it's growing, it's vibrant, and we need a plan for the future. We need a roadmap, as we all know. And this is why it's so crucial, the fact that you were here, you participated, and your enthusiasm is very evident. Thank you so much, Laredo. So we'll pass it on to our folks. And it's still open for comments, so please state your comments.
Hello, everybody. Our mic is off, so I hope you can hear me. I'm with Frank Kikkenia, a joint venture for the comprehensive plan of the City of Laredo. I just want to tell you all the
sorry.
An incredible journey that I have had the honor to be taking with most of you in this room, because I recognize most of you have come to one meeting or another in the last 10 days and even before. The City of Laredo Comprehensive Plan is mandated.
The City of Laredo Comprehensive Plan has to be done by city charter. The city charter says that we shall have a comprehensive plan that governs the development of the city, the goals and the policies of the city, and that it be adopted and readopted every year. We haven't gone through this process in 25 years to this extent, and you all have to realize that what is happening right now through this process is that we are creating the city that we all go visit and spend our money at, and our children go and live to, and many times do not come back to Laredo. We spend our hard-earned money, our treasure, raising our kids through the schools. We send them to college. We spend our money educating them, and then the other cities get the benefit. They take our treasure. So now we're gonna have the kind of city that we know that we will now be spending our money in, that our children will come back to and enjoy and wanna live here and work here, because this is about diversity in the economy and having places that we all love to live, work, and play. And we're gonna get there with your input. And all the images and information that you will receive tonight is basically, probably all of it has come from you. And I'm very proud to be able to also pass this mic over to Mario, who's been an incredible firm to work with on this project, including every other consultant.
Thank you, Ivan. So I'm going to pull you away from us chatting up here. We've been working with Roxanne Peña. She's been filming all of the events that we've had, going way back to the New Urbanism Film Festival that we did a couple of weeks ago. And so we just have a very, very quick teaser of the documentary that is being produced about this comprehensive plan.
Do the things that you're thinking about. If you don't act upon it, nobody else is going to do it.
Every city has a strategic plan. There are people that want things. There are people that are trying to make things happen and make that change that we so need in this city. And there are movers and shakers that are willing to play the part.
This comprehensive plan is ours. The more people get into this, the more that people are engaged in this process, the more that this will become a reality.
We need to make a couple changes, as there needs to be some improvements done here in Laredo, and I think the best part is just getting the word out, letting people know that, hey, your word matters. What you say will make an impact on this city.
So very quickly, just to let you know who's working on this team, but more importantly, what aspects we're tackling here as we try to build this comprehensive plan. And like you can see here on the screen, it is very comprehensive. So Frank Hickey Peña, Architects Joint Venture, we're leading the team as project managers. Dover Cole and Partners, they're here out of Miami. They set up shop here for the last 2 weeks. And I'd like to really give them a round of applause because they've been incredible. They've said goodbye to their families. They've stepped away for 2 weeks and they've helped Laredo come up with some really, really great ideas. And they've helped us come up with some great visualizations of what those ideas would look like in real life. So we're excited to show you all of their work here tonight. We have Walkability Exports. An economic development expert, Angelou Economics. I believe he's back there. So, where is he? Here he is. So you'll see. You'll hear more from him tonight. All right. A transportation and mobility expert. Where's AB? There you go. A housing consultant, infrastructure, environmental, subdivisions and annexation, and then we're working with a landscape architect. Very accomplished. To help us come up with a meaningful landscape ordinance that really ties into our climate here in Laredo. So it's a great team. We've been really very, very happy to work with them and honored to work with them. What we did, Iviana, Frank, and I, is we went out and we looked for world-class consultants that would not otherwise work here in Laredo. And so I think, if anything, what we've done is we've gathered the best people from around the country to help us make this a great plan. And then we've also tried to get as many Laredoans involved. And I think for that, you all take the credit. And I want to give you guys a round of applause. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here. Thank you for coming. So this is a quote we like to use from the first first meeting we had here with the mayor, he said, don't be afraid to plan big. And that's how we kicked this off 2 weeks ago. And I think you'll see that we weren't afraid of that. Or you all weren't afraid of that. And this is from our city manager, Chuy Olivares. Laredo should be the most livable city in South Texas. And so this plan is you telling us what the most livable city in South Texas should be, what it should look like. And so with that, I'll pass this over to Frank. Tell us a little bit more about the comprehensive plan.
Thanks. Thanks, Mario. Of course, some of you have been involved in this process. A lot of you in this room have been coming, whether it's been a focus group meeting or just a public activity. So for those of you that are here for the first time and want to know a little bit more about what this is exactly what it says there. This is our guiding document to direct our capital improvements, to develop projects, and really it's our blueprint, it's our footprint of how we're going to grow in the next year and the next 25 years. And that's really what this document is. It's our guiding light. We, as the consultants of this process, are not the authors of this document. It is all of us together. It's the citizens, it's our elected officials, it's our city staff, and you, not only over the past 10 days, but we embarked on this project, we began this project back in June. Collecting data, having various meetings with city, with citizens. And what's really cool about this process, which is really unique about this process, is after collecting all that data and having all those meetings, then we locked ourselves up in this room for 10 days. And a lot of you were part of that. And this is an overview of some of the things that happened. It was last Tuesday night, in this very same room, we had a bunch of round tables. Now you're sitting in this kind of seated area, but we had a bunch of round tables. And really, everybody rolled up their sleeves and got to work and told us what they want to see in the city, what you want. And there's some examples of that. We had an amazing turnout. I think we had 17 tables of various projects. You're going to get to see some of those draft projects tonight. It's also important to note that tonight is not the end of the process. Tonight is the end of the 10-day public workshop. This process will still continue, and we will get continuous feedback and make this document the document and the city that we want the city to be. We had the Open Design Studio. Aside from the actual kickoff meeting, we had an open studio over the past 10 days, and that schedule's there as you walk out to see anybody at any time could walk in, sit down with an urban designer, an engineer, an environmentalist, an architect, and talk about where they're living, what they want to see, how they want to get from one place to another, what was important to them. And these are some of the examples of what was happening in this very room. We had an amazing event last Sunday with the millennials. They came together, and we had a group of about 27 young people came in this room. They said that they were going to come for an hour, and I think they stayed for 4 hours working with our team of consultants. And that was incredibly inspiring because this is their future. And they want to stay here, and they want to live here, and they want to raise their families here. And so we need to engage them in this process, and they were engaged. Our team itself that came in from different parts of the country, we spent a complete days driving around Laredo, letting them get to know Laredo. We did walking tours of our downtown, of our historic area, of our inner cities, and we were showing them what we love about this city and what we don't love about this city. And so that was a really great exchange as well. I mean, we even went to the extent of, as we planned our transportation mapping, our bike maps, we did ourselves, some of the urban designers that you'll meet a little bit later, and AB, our transportation consultant, we did a 27 and then later another 6 mile ride around the city, and we actually mapped the trails, we mapped the streets, and we connected the dots. And then ultimately, not only the 25-year-olds, we went down to the 6 and 7-year-olds and had a really cool workshop over at HB Zachary last week, as well as we engaged 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th graders from LBJ High School that that came in here and did the same exercise that many of you did a week ago in this room. We had technical meetings that focused areas that we brought in people that were experts in these areas, as well as we had these meetings open to the public. And these are some of the things that we focused on that ultimately will hopefully make this a very successful comprehensive plan. We had this, we talked about the schools and education, as we all know, that was a premier number one aspect of what this plan needed to focus on. We talked with city officials, developers, architects, engineers. We had our cycling community here. We had people that were involved in housing, transportation, parks, rec, green space. I mean, I can go on. You can read this list. I don't need to read it to you. But we really engaged a lot of different aspects of our community and how that would ultimately mold our comprehensive plan. Jason, I'm going to hand it over to you. Jason, this is Jason King from Dover Coal.
So as the mayor mentioned, we work in a lot of cities all over the country, all over the world. Much bigger cities produce far fewer people. This is a phenomenal number. If we count all the new people in this room, we're probably over 1,000, talking face to face in meetings like this or across the table. We've been covered by the newspapers. We're front page this morning in the later morning times. We're liked, we're followed on Facebook. 50,000 people have in one way or another digitally touch the plan. So now we're going to tell you what we heard as part of that conversation. You remember a lot of you did the one-word card, right? We asked you one word that comes to mind about Laredo now and in the future. And people wrote down their answers, and the more times they wrote a word, the larger it appeared. One word that comes to mind about Laredo now. Right, so you see home and growing. You also see parking and traffic. Boring is large, but I tell you, your chief of police is very proud of that moniker.
Proud of having a boring city.
There are other cities that are less boring. Mexico City, Juarez, Nuevo Laredo, Miami, where I'm from, is a lot less boring. I could use more boring in my life. One word that comes to mind about Laredo in the future, you see vibrant and progressive, growing. The word city appears. It's as if Laredo is about to make a transition in some ways. We've been telling people the one word that comes to mind about today was a little more negative than we see in other places. Boring, that's something like 40 people. But there are almost no negative words when it comes to the future. Laredans believe that the future will be better than the past, and they're looking forward to the future. And that's the fun part about planning in this city. So there are five big ideas, and these five big ideas are basically the chapters of the presentation we're going to give tonight. And I won't spend much time on this slide because we're going to show you what these things mean visually. The five big ideas are create an attractive, walkable destinations, make the downtown great, complete the streets, plan new and improved public spaces, and to create a prosperous but still affordable Laredo. Everyone gets to stay. So, enough about us. Let's do a poll. Does everybody have a keypad polling device? If you don't have, just raise your hand and we'll come over and give you one. Oh, all right. Right. Yeah, so we seem to be out of them. So exactly, if it's couples, then share. I recommend you give it to your wife. Okay, first question. Did you attend the kickoff presentation or visit the studio? You would push one for yes, I came to the kickoff. You'd push two for yes, I visited the studio or one of the technical meetings. You'd push three for both, and you'd push four for neither. You can enter your answer. The last answer that you push is the one that counts, and your vote only counts once. You ready? All right, good. This is exciting. So almost half the room, this is your first time to Viva Laredo. And the other half, we have some people who have been to just about everything, 25%. And we've had people who came to the kickoff, your ideas of what we're presenting tonight. Have you been to the website, vivalaredo.com?
.org.
.org. That's right. This is a little plug for the website. The idea is all the plans, all the renderings, all these movies we're making are going to be on that website. So if someone you know was not able to come, direct them to vivalaredo.org. All right, wow. A lot of people have. Excellent. Questions get a little harder. How often do you dine or shop in the downtown area? Be honest. All right, so this is interesting, right? There are some people in the room, the downtown is not part of their life. Most people still go downtown, but it's very rare, only a few times a year. And then there's some highly committed people, 11% are there all the time. But for the most part, you know, this is something to improve upon. If this plan is done right, then in the next 15 years, when we ask this question, more people will know the downtown. Let's ask about biking. How often do you ride a bike? Whether recreation or commuting? There's laughing, there's scoffing. It's true. All right, so half the room. Nope, not on a bike. The other half, some degree. Often do you go to Mexico? Wow. 40% never. 40% a few times a year, and the rest basically sometimes. Now, what about 15 years ago? We went across the border yesterday, and it looks different, we're told, by our local escort. So let you tell me, 15 years ago, how often did you go to Mexico before things start to change over there? Look at that shift, right? So 15 years ago, people were going there once or twice a week, or once or twice a month. A big part of this plan is going to be tying the city back together again. Nuevo Laredo and Laredo, for a lot of people, are one city, with just a small river in between them. We've been working with their planners. We've had a chance to tour. Reinforcing those connections is very important. Well, I'll tell you, so the last 2 weeks, I've been living in downtown Laredo. And these are my kids. We enrolled them in the school. And this is us at La Posada getting up in the morning and doing the commute. And I got to know the downtown. I got to be a real fan of the downtown. And so when we asked people, you know, to give us their ideas about the future, they said, make the downtown great. And they did that by things like this. They circled words like restaurants and coffee shop, residential living, trolleys. They said historic preservation and wrote that on the maps. It's interesting to see the cluster on the bike master plan that we did. People were placing a lot of stickers there. They put a P for parking garage, and they said things like, one way, go away. You know that the downtown right now has a lot of empty second and third floors, right? And the shops there are important and they're fun, but they're really only intended for one kind of shopper for the most part. It's just astounding that there would be one-story metal buildings in the middle of the downtown. This is something that the plan needs to work on, as well as restoring the great architectural treasures, like the plaza. On the topic of historic preservation, you're still at the point in your history where you're losing architectural gems like that, which is tough, because as great as the architects are in this room, they will never be able to build something as good as that. And so historic preservation has to be part of the plan. Now, the downtown mall is coming. The $80 million of investment, 77 new stores. Everyone's excited about that. Where I'm from, the downtown mall in West Palm Beach is interesting and fun. But what I'm really excited about is how that investment created life on Clematis Street, the cool mix of little shops and galleries that's right near the mall. Or where I grew up, the downtown mall, the Providence Place Mall, helped to revive Wabasset Street and PPAC and the bookstores and the places that I go. I think we should expect that the downtown mall is going to change things quite a bit in the downtown. And your streets that surround that mall, like its street, you know, like Convent, we're going to start to see a transformation. We started to imagine if the downtown suddenly saw buildings that used to be boarded up no longer being boarded up, and the Angelo Parkway being sort of revisited in terms of design, revamped, little facelift. What if? The plan looks at very small and simple solutions like that, adding awnings, bringing people back. And then there's the big ideas. So you know that there was only ever two trolleys in the United States, in North America, that crossed the border. One in El Paso and one in Laredo. And Laredo's was the first international electric tramway in the world, you know? But it went away, eventually. El Paso got their streetcars back. They were stored out by the airport in the desert. They went out, they brought them back. They got a grant from the federal government. And they're building perhaps one less highway and adding streetcars to their downtown. So that got us imagining. This is Convent Avenue. This is looking toward Mexico, right? There's Norton's, there's a lot of the stores that you recognize. A lot of people walk that street. There's a lot of life on that street. Right now, though, it's effectively a one-way street. We started to imagine, what if? What if Convent saw an electric streetcar once again? It's got the El Metro colors. It has the traditional style, the electric wires up ahead to create a sustainable thing. This is a streetcar that would be in traffic. Cars would be moving around it just like was once there. The bike lane remains. Public investment like streetcars is followed by private investment. If you invest in your downtown, then some of those bricked up windows will suddenly see glass again. And some of those, there's a second floor, there's a third floor behind there. Could start to see balconies and people living downtown. What if? That's the idea of the plan. Now, in talking to people about the downtown, everyone talked about parking, right? Siete Banderas has a concert, and all of a sudden, there's absolutely nowhere to park in the downtown. It's clear you're going to need, and they have a concert every night, so that's an issue. You're going to need more parking in the downtown. Our recommendation is that when parking garages go in, they look less like this, and more like you did on the El Metro Transit Station. There's a big parking garage there, right? But it's got a face. It's wonderfully lined. The plan needs to look at how when a garage goes in, there can be sides to it and fronts to it. Oops. There can be a top to it. And we can put in parking garages that are also urbanistically interesting and architecturally valuable. There are a lot of places in the downtown where food could be grown. You've heard the term food desert, right? It's with the closing of the HEB, people living downtown have very few options. In the short term, we could imagine, just like in the most valuable real estate in the country, in New York City and Manhattan, they have gardens downtown, people growing produce. That concept could work in the different neighborhoods. The concept of urban agriculture, just kids growing carrots in beds and learning where food comes from and getting more healthy options and building an ethic of healthy food. Now, downtowns also have art, and cities have art. And we had to look far and wide on the city to find big sculptures like you see. And I guess this is one. So the Department of Transportation, patrons of the arts that they are, gave you this art, and you drive past it very fast. And I don't know how we got this picture. I hope that person is still alive. Not so much. We need more art like this, right? The murals of Azteca. Big art characterized big cities. Big, beautiful, colorful statues and murals and paintings and paint the ground and paint the road and paint the stairs. wherever you can. This is what the plan talks about, a boulevard of the Americas. When you come out of Mexico on 35, there is a plan for full solid blocks of art and design and green space. That's a part of the plan. The downtown plan as we have it is very detailed. But from what you can see, what I like about the plan is that it's not tearing anything down or it's not closing any streets. The red is for historic buildings that need a facelift. The pink are for new buildings that need to be strategically inserted. We're trying to revive the creeks. We're trying to create more access to the downtown. And we're trying to bring more people. So let's talk about how we start in the downtown, in the downtown neighborhoods. What's one small project, take just a few blocks, and how do you make the vision start to come true?
Thank you. I'm Joseph Cole with Dover Cole. I work with Jason. You know, we spend a lot of time looking at downtowns. What all the downtowns that have started to come back across the United States are those that are starting to introduce more housing into downtown. And so that's really what is needed to really start to make some change. And often it can be small. We know we were looking at the codes, the zoning codes for the city. We've got older neighborhoods, historic buildings mixed in among the blocks. Those could still stay. The scale of buildings could still be in character, but yet we're adding more places to live in or near the downtown. And so this is just one example. This is 10 apartment buildings. And we looked to see if we could actually add this to one of the blocks. And so we looked at the code. And in this case, it's 10 units. There's four two-bedroom apartments and two three-bedroom apartments fit on that site. Parking could be in the back, so it takes some of the cars off the street. But we also noticed that the code had, we were positioning the building a little closer to the street, like you see the older buildings do here in Laredo. But the zoning code pushes the buildings back 20 feet. And so we know when you push the building back 20 feet off the street, usually you get the cars in the front parking there and not behind. And that creates a scene of your street will start to look like a parking lot. So that's something that takes away from the unique character that Laredo has. And then also there are requirements so that you have to have a certain amount of land for a certain number of units. It's really complicated to calculate, so maybe we could work on that to simplify it. But to do 10 units, actually you need more than just the two lots. And so that makes it more complicated because there's we know there's a lot of different ownership in each block, and so it's harder to assemble properties to get enough land to put in units. So maybe that could be looked at as well as a way to try to jumpstart it. So let's say that you could do this 10-unit building on two lots, and then we could convince an urban pioneer to come in and build one of these units, and it takes off. And then others start to follow suit. And so again, you're keeping the good buildings, the historic buildings, and working that in. And then eventually you're building up more of a residential population adjacent to the downtown. And so then maybe, and I'm sorry?
Could you buy your apartment?
Perhaps, yeah, it depends on who's building it, yeah. That would be great. So then property values start to go up. Somebody comes in and says there's a real market here, and then you can get larger buildings that perhaps have come with parking garages. And this week we heard a lot of folks talking about adding a garage on this particular block. It's of course we're just north of this particular study area is just north of the incoming outlet mall, and so that's a city-owned parking lot. So again, that come in place. Jason was showing you the liners to the garage that could be wrapping the garage. So it doesn't look like a garage from the street, again, adding that character. And then a big idea would be to take one of those blocks where there's not valuable architecture there and actually create a new plaza. And so, again, that's in keeping with the character of the city, built on the tradition that you once had when there were 27 plazas here. and again, create that street life sense of place that would be attractive. Now, the city could do that, but most cases, you would probably try to find the private sector to do it. And if they're going to do it, they have to offset the cost, so they're going to need a little bit more density, a little more intensity for their development if they're paying for it. But there's ways to make that happen.
So the second big idea was to create attractive, walkable locations. So people were presenting to us, they circled the universities, and they said those are opportunities for mixed use. They talk about senior living near the universities, and food trucks, and employment, and I really liked this. Entertainment is 30-minute drive north for us in South Laredo. Please change that. If you remember that first night, those of you, the half of you that were there for the kickoff, we showed you two images, and we asked you to weigh in on them with the keypads. And you liked this one, the one on your left. Half the people liked it. And you did not like this one, right? 95% of the people said no, and we want less of that in Laredo. It's interesting. You know, most of the United States looks like this. But we were saying that we wanted a few more places that look like this. This isn't historic. This is all new construction. The street is narrower. People are on it. So we took that idea. We started to imagine how places could change. On St. Ursula and Jefferson, right near the highway, there's a spot where the buildings are sort of just there. They're not really addressing the street. What if? Imagine if those area could get sort of the development regulations could change, the development potential of those spots could be unlocked. If that hotel could get a new face, and if that concept of the plaza could extend to even a spot like that. You know, imagine if we allowed them to build a little higher and a little closer to the street, if we allowed them to put the parking in the back, and if you actually created sort of a gateway spot in an area that you might just drive by otherwise. Then you take that concept even further. This is West Del Mar. Del Mar is in many ways like the new Main Street of Laredo. And so there's West Del Mar, here's the HEB, here's the Target, right? I-35 is something like this. You come off of I-35 and you're onto Del Mar, okay? It's a landscape you know well. It's when you drive it, it's basically your most dominant visual image is parking. There are trees, but for the most part, it's a drive-only environment. Now, the energy of Del Mar is sort of moving east, right? And we don't want this area to be forgotten. So this is a place where you could, again, change the regulations to allow parking lots to become houses or commercial or offices. You could allow these boxes that are sort of frozen in time by the setbacks and the FAR to actually transform. Green spaces could be created where there's now asphalt. Trees could be planted where there's now concrete. And slowly, a place like Del Mar could transform over time. Now, if you look at this, it looks like a village. There's a mix of housing types. There's a church. There's towers. And all those in-between areas saw development. In plan, it looks like this. Here's the Target. Here's I-35. And we're just fitting all that stuff where nothing would have gone otherwise. All kinds of greens. There's still plenty of parking for shops. There's still, all the drainage requirements are met. But we're looking at places that would have otherwise been skipped over. Now, who would live there? Who would actually want to live between the highway and Target? Who would want to live on Del Mar and effectively the parking lot of HEB? Even if it looked like this, even if it looked like a village with people sitting outside, even if it was a multi-story, mixed-use, walkable environment with obelisks in the park, who would want to live there? The answer is that if you build a little more densely, by virtue of building densely, you can lower rents, right? So if the rents are cheaper, then the younger singles and couples, empty nesters, older people who are tired of mowing the lawn might want to live in an apartment. And take a walk to the coffee shop. New parents who can't afford the first mortgage of a single family house on a large lot. Young families, single parents. What we're trying to do is create options in Laredo. Change the regulations to create options so that way there's more room for people and we can build a more affordable place. Now, if you remember, those of you who came to the Jeff Speck meeting, he told us Laredo is growing fast. It doesn't feel that way, but it is. You're seeing 140 people a week. That's the US Census. It's not our number. You right now have a population of around 230, 240. By 2050, your population, by 2050, so a lot of people in this room will see that. Maybe not me, but a lot of people will see that. By 2050, your population will double. You're like this dark blue area, one of the most growing places in a very growing state. And what Jeff said is, don't do everything the way you did it before. Don't just have these pods of houses off by themselves, surrounded by nothing. Don't have pods of workplaces, the offices that are in the middle of parking lots, and then the disconnected shopping centers that you have to drive to, and the schools out on the farthest, cheapest piece of land. Jeff Speck's challenge to us, the author of the book Walkability, who presented earlier in this charrette, was to take all of those things, red for retail, and purple for school, and green for park, and yellow for office, and blue for institutional, and mix them like you once did. There's all those same uses. You need all that stuff. You need houses and workplaces and apartments and shopping. But why not mix them like you once did? Why not revive the idea of the square, the placita? So we take that concept. Where would it make the most sense? It probably would make the most sense around the colleges because there are students who are younger and the younger people are more interested in walking. And Laredo Community College offers a lot of people, especially a lot of non-traditional students, a very good chance at colleges and education. But the one thing that Laredo Community College South cannot yet offer is like the campus experience. You know, so we just started looking at the best campuses in the world, Harvard Square and Cambridge. This isn't even the campus. This is the energy and the life around the campus, the bookstores and the movie houses and the restaurants and the bars. That mix of people and uses is something that LCC does not have yet, right? The best places in the country, I grew up going to school, we went to Thayer Street, we could meet all kinds of different people. There's different ethnicities represented, there's different kinds of restaurants, there's all kinds of interesting shopping. The best part of Paris is the best part of Paris because it's the one that has the colleges and the universities, the Latin Quarter. Or even, like, not even Paris, but, you know, in Oklahoma City, the best part of Oklahoma is the campus corner by the University of Oklahoma. I've seen all of Oklahoma, and this is my favorite part. It's where people are out and eating. Young people and old, students and faculty, residents and visitors all mingle. So that, what would a campus town look like in Laredo? Now there's a lot of land, you're still growing. On this map you can see Laredo Community College, you see the big huge buildings and the enormous parking lots of a drive-only commuter college, but there's all kinds of green land just east of it. And we were imagining there that what you would build is a network of streets and small main streets, and what that looks like is this. There's the college. Here's a road students could walk. This is as interesting an experience as you find in Cambridge, Massachusetts, or in the Latin Quarter. And that walk takes you to the plaza, and there's a mix of people and excitement and vibrancy. And there's another reason to go to LCC besides just the campus and the experience. What if? You know, what if we could create this kind of thing? People underneath the portales, underneath the arches and the galleries, and just sitting and dining, and students having a true campus experience in the South, a glowing center of activity in the South, and they wouldn't have to drive north for coffee shops and restaurants and stores. And that same concept could be applied to all of your colleges and to the university. Texas A&M has a lot of students that feel kind of trapped. You know, they're on that campus, and this is a Chick-fil-A, and this is a little Burger King, and there's things that they can eat, right? But there's so much land around that, and you're still a growing city. And so we imagine that same kind of thing, a mix of people and a mix of buildings, and commercial main streets and activity and life. And now occasionally, on those spots, you know, your colleges, your universities, they're all on the loop, or they're on major roads, or they're on roads that are going to become bigger. The welcome doesn't always have to be something like this. You could imagine keeping your freeway next to a highway with a highway on the other side, like Texas builds its expressways, but fronting those big transportation facilities a little differently, creating smaller streets, little local streets, access lanes. And that whole idea of presenting a proud image of the city for people who are just driving by. Another idea was to complete the streets. People drew little bicyclists like this, or it's someone on a horse, but it's definitely not a car. And they placed the stickers for bike trails and street trees, and they wrote speed limit. And Mines Road, you know, Mines Way was talked about quite a bit. People were talking about bike lanes on Park Street. Right now, on Del Mar and a lot of the city, on your major arterials, on your big roads, people want to walk and they want to bike, and they're out there, but they're putting themselves quite often in dangerous situations because they're on skinny little sidewalks next to big trucks, the Silverados, and that are moving at 55 miles an hour, you know? We're looking at those arterials. We're looking at ones that don't see too much traffic, that are very, very wide, and they have extra space. And we're looking at right-sizing those. And by right-sizing, I mean putting pedestrian and bicycle facilities right in the street, but protecting them, like this one, which has a concrete barrier protecting these bicyclists. And there's on-street parking, another wall of cars for, you know, to protect them. It's hard to imagine really taking a bike onto Clark right now. This lane is very wide, the cars are moving very fast. The sidewalk typically does not have any trees, although there is some. Trees have been cut down in this case, but building streets that people want to be. And when you do that, when people are traveling by bike or on foot, the buildings change too. You know, the buildings don't always have to have signage like that and parking right out front. They can be taller, mixed use and multi-story. What if? Not just the north, going back down to the south, connecting South Laredo. South Laredo is connected by the loop, but there are all these north-south streets that run your excellent grid of streets. We're looking at Louisiana and New York Avenue with all the schools, Dr. Sigueroa and Zachary Elementary and United South. And these roads right now, people are parking over here, and the road's really wide, and kids could be on that street, but the sidewalk falls apart at the curb cuts, and there's nothing to help them cross. If you take that kind of street, which is so typical, and you put it into the computer model, this is what you have. It's kind of a meager place, really, for pedestrians. There's no trees. Cars are moving very fast. It's easy to retrofit streets like this. It's easy to place bike facilities and street trees and potentially even lamps for safety. Community members are helping us identify what the first priority places should be, and there's state and federal funding to retrofit and to redesign streets and to create main streets in the future in the South. There's regulations have to change, guidebooks have to be adopted, there's work that has to be done, but we would like to make the streets of Laredo safe, comfortable, and interesting, not just for cars, but for bikes and for pedestrians and for kids and for older folks too. Complete the streets is a big part of the plan. But I'm not a traffic engineer, so let's bring up a traffic engineer, a professional licensed traffic person to tell us about the specifics of completing the streets.
Hi, my name is A.B. Salinas, and we looked at the transportation infrastructure, and most of the time when we think about that, we think about the roads, we think about traffic and congestion and the automobile. I don't know if I have a laser pointer, but so most of the time we think about our transportation infrastructure in relation to how we experience it in the car. But like any balanced diet, if this is like a food pyramid, We really want to have a nice distribution of your grains and your vegetables, and then a little bit of your meat. The components to a balanced diet would be something that has a lot of walkability, walking, cycling, public transit, carpooling, and of course the car. Now we know that in Laredo and across the country, most of the people get around by automobile. This total for driving and carpooling is around 96%. And you know, we looked at where Laredo stood in comparison to the nation. We found that we're dead last in bicycle commuting to work, and we're pretty near the bottom on walkability. So we're probably somewhere around 98%. We're very auto-centric. This is a map of congestion in the city of Laredo and the county. Green represents free-flowing traffic. Red represents a highly congested area. We call it maybe a gridlock. This is today, and if we continue to be an auto-centric city that we don't, where we don't distribute that diet, well then we're slowly marching towards this. And so 25 years from now, if we continue on the same path, then we're basically gonna go in all red. And there's only so much we can do in terms of creating new roads, adding lanes, speeding up traffic. At some point you reach a saturation level. So what can we do to change that future? Another thing that comes with that is the more cars that we have on there, the more accidents that come with it. So this is a little bit of old data. This is, I think, from, I don't know if it's 2008 to 2012, but this is a map of the top 20 crash locations in the city. The circles are top collision locations, and then the X's are actually fatalities. And you see that a lot of the, I guess, the fatal accidents come in areas that are with higher speeds. And then on the right side, we have bicycle and pedestrian locations. These little circle clusters, the larger they are, that means the more accidents that involve a pedestrian or a cyclist. And as you'd expect, there's probably more in the downtown area because there's more pedestrians and there's more people who bike in that area. So what can we do to improve the safety? This is a very busy map, but this is really important in terms of how do we design our streets and how do we create a street that's inviting not just for the car, but for the person, the cyclist. And all these numbers represent average daily traffic counts. And if you see, you look around, all these numbers are pretty low, 800, 3,000, 1,700. And we like to think that, or kind of a rule of thumb is if the number is 30,000, and that's kind of the threshold for two-way, four lanes. And there's been a lot of attention and discussion about the downtown area. And if you look at the traffic counts, you see that they're, in many areas, very low. I mean, we have 300, 1,100, 500, 2,400, way below 30,000, and well below 15,000. So 15,000 is kind of that threshold where we think there's a lot of opportunity to do a lot of creative things. And so what does a great street look like? And this is an image of a street that is just, it's efficient, it connects neighborhoods. In many ways, a roadway can divide a community. It provides choices in transportation. You see that there's bike lanes, and you can imagine that there's public transit, there's shade, crosswalks for nice wide sidewalks. This isn't representative of maybe every street in the city, but for a major road, this is something that it could look like. And this is something that we would say is safe, and it promotes affordable transportation choices. In our discussions over the last couple of weeks, we've spent a lot of time talking about the downtown area. So we went and we spent some time looking at that area in further detail. So this is a map of the downtown area. This is the traffic flow. So red represents one-way streets and blue represents two-way streets. And you'll see that, you know, generally in the prime area of the downtown, it's all one-ways. And if you're anybody like myself, when I go downtown, I find it to be confusing.
I don't really know where I'm going. I could become disoriented. And a lot of times people complain about not being able to find parking. So, you know, what can we do to improve this? And in many of the roads, reflecting, let's go back again and think about the traffic counts. They're really low. So there's opportunities not to, we can change this one-way paradigm and look at areas that we could do two-way traffic. So that's what we did, is we kind of reimagined what it would look like if we did two ways. In addition to that, we looked at creating on-street bike routes. And so this is in yellow, for instance, showing Washington Street connecting the Heights and the Azteca and the Zacate Creek and all the way down to LCC and then into the downtown area. And the brown down here represents trails. So this was something that could be if that's what we're looking for. And on a street level, kind of zooming in on some of the areas, this is Convent Street, traffic count less than 4,000. Currently one way northbound, and as of recently, the last couple of weeks, it got striped to a bike lane, so that's really great. And kind of continuing on what Jason talked about is, what if we added streetcars to this equation, and what if we made this two ways? Well, you know, we could do that. It fits, and it might look something like this. Another area is Matamoros Street, which goes from east to west. Currently, it goes eastbound, so out of downtown. This is the section. You have 15-foot wide lanes. Roughly, the sidewalks vary, but it doesn't need to be this wide. So what if we created, again, a two-way street, added parking to people coming into the downtown area, and even had a little bit of room to expand the sidewalks to improve that walkability? Continuing on that discussion of downtown, a lot of people have talked about the parking situation. So we wanted to look at that again a little bit further. Everything in blue represents surface or structured parking in the downtown area. And we kind of mapped out just a little bit, get an idea of what we were looking at. We drew a circle, and this line represents roughly 800 feet. And that might represent something like the 3-minute walk. And often when we're talking about the comfortable walk, we say 5 minutes is the comfortable walk. We know it's hot here, so let's just say it's 3 minutes. So drawing a line here, you can see there's parking. If you can find it, there's parking out there. But we recognize that there's still a need for additional parking in the area, but we feel that one way to really improve the parking situation that's cost effective is just to create ways where people know where they're going. So adding wayfinding and signage as you go into the downtown area, having parking signs, directing people to where things are, where the sites are, and even including a map that might suggest a historic walk route or show you which shops and stores are in the downtown area. Another area that received a lot of attention during the past couple of weeks was the industrial area on Mines Road. And as you can see, this is a Google traffic map, kind of at rush hour, 5 p.m. at the end of the day. And you can see everything that's in red is highly congested. Mines Road is, I mean, just almost all red. And then you have a lot of red coming down the loop and then going to southbound on 35. I understand that, you know, we recently completed a southbound lane on the Mines Road, and so we'll see how that improves the situation. And there's probably opportunities to continue the efficiency there. But one area that we kind of looked at a little bit more was this intersection right here. As the person who works in this area, at the end of the day, wants to go home, and maybe he lives there in the south part of town. This is an aerial representation of that same map. And what you see here are three different locations where people are jumping off the highway onto the access road just to try to make this turn over here. And then at this point, you have a little protected right turn lane and then a traffic signal. The off-ramp is somewhere over here. And ideally, what we would have is something like a flyover that takes us from here and takes us down to 35. And that's something that's planned in the future, but it's still a ways away. And not that it can't be reprioritized, let's just think about ways that we can kind of remedy the situation immediately. And this is something we've just begun looking at, so we don't really know the answer or have a solution, but you know, things that we could reinvestigate or look at is expanding the capacity of that right turn lane, bringing out another lane, and then rethinking the configuration of the on and off ramps in this area. And maybe that would be something that improves the situation. We've also heard discussion that there's people that take a bike from the south part of town, ride the metro, come up, ride their bike around the industrial area, and then go back down. And a continued theme throughout this conversation has been the need for a complete bicycle network. And so Kenneth is an individual who rides his bike every day, no matter what the weather is. And so he really completely understands what it takes to create a great network. So let me pass it to Kenneth.
Good evening. So Kenneth Garcia, I live in Miami. And an interesting thing just about me and my wife, we actually sold our car a couple years ago. So biking is our primary means of transportation. We were brought in here to take a look at the bike network in Laredo and help you create the first bicycle master plan. So we actually had a great chance to go out and ride all over the city. We did about 27 miles with Frank, and we did some off-road trails, and we did a lot of on-street lanes as well. And you have a lot of beautiful trails that have been built recently. But you also have some really like scary moments where you get to the end of a lane and it just disappears and you're just stuck in a highway. So if we're thinking about expanding the transportation options in the city, biking is one of those. But it's not for everyone. If you look at the statistics nationally, there's different kinds of bicyclists. So about 1% of the population would be in the strong, less than 1%, in the strong and fearless category. And that's actually probably most of the bicyclists that you see in Laredo fall into that category. there's another slightly larger group that's enthused and confident. And so I fall somewhere, you know, in between there, probably more on this side. And so you see in a lot of cities, a lot more of that group is coming out. And those are people that they're comfortable generally riding on streets as long as it's safe enough, there's not too much traffic. But they're not gonna go out there if they feel unsafe at all. There's also another like 33% that there's nothing you're gonna do to get that person on a bike, and that's fine. We don't need to do anything to, you know, they don't need to get on a bike. But this is a really interesting number, 60%.
What are the age ranges of all
this? It varies, but I would expect this to be, you know, older and younger people included. But this number right here, these are people that are interested in biking. They see the benefits to transportation, to health, to the environment. But there is no way you're gonna get that person on a bike unless they feel safe, unless it's comfortable, and unless, you know, they don't have any worries about what they're getting themselves into. So that's kind of the holy grail right there. And that's what we would like to work towards. You might not get to 60%, but if you at least get part of that number out, even if it's not every day, you know, on weekends, that would be a huge improvement. So Laredo has a some interesting challenges and opportunities. There's a lot of Laredo that looks like this, that has a big, dense grid of streets. And that's actually really helpful for biking and walking, because you can take a lot of different routes. If there's one route that has more traffic, you can take one that's parallel to that. But a lot of the newer neighborhoods that are getting built look more like this. So this is at the same scale. And you can see there's so many fewer connections. So the connections that are there need to be a lot bigger and carry a lot more traffic. And that's where you have challenges for people who are biking and walking. So as we look forward to the future, we need to start looking at how to reconnect those areas. And if we're building new areas, make sure that they're connected enough so that people feel comfortable going around. So we're looking at different kinds of bike infrastructure, from just your normal bike lane to a more comfortable buffered bike lane, depending on the street. And you know, more and more around the country, you start seeing the premier cycling routes. So we're starting to take a look at where in the city those can be. And so in the back of the room, there's maps where people were placing stickers, and were helping us to identify where some of these things could go. We've been looking at the map and at our own experience and trying to find places for these. And the city right now looks like this. It has just a few legs of bike paths and trails. So our first draft priority routes looks like this. So if we can, so for example, this is International Springfield. That would be a really important route that connects a lot of a big part of the city. And if we're successful, then we can expand that further. So you know, in small streets, you might just be able to add trees, or like Springfield International, there's room to have a full buffer bike lane. And as you go out, you could have a bigger trail on the side of the road, or even do bigger street transformations than that. So that's our draft.
All right, take out the keypads. We've given you a lot of information. Now let's get your opinion on some of the things that we've talked about. We talked about a streetcar in the downtown. Do you like this idea? Push one for yes, two for probably yes, three for can't tell yes, or rather can't tell yet, and four for no.
What was the idea?
The idea was streetcars downtown, more people living down there. All right, so that's like 80-95. So that's about 94% of people, either yes or probably yes. Which amenities are most lacking in the downtown? Places to dine, places to shop, places to work, places to live, parking, bike facilities, lighting, shade, benches, street trees and parks, or something else?
All of the above.
Yeah, that's right. See, we didn't do all of the above because we knew you'd pick it. This is a tough one, because it is true. The answer is all of the above. This is a tough one. You can pick two. You can pick two. The last two that you push are the ones that will register.
The Laredo Public Library will be closing in 30 minutes. Again, the library will be closing in 30 minutes. Thank you.
And we better start moving faster. All right. Look at that. So 32% of places to live. Pronto. Places to live was number one. Places to dine, number two. And parking, right? That's interesting. But all those things were important. We talked about this on the Clark Park Street dedicated bike lane. What did you think about that idea? All right, look at that. So 80% said yes, 16% said probably yes. Some people do not like that idea, and that is important. Do you think it is likely that increased transit, like the streetcar we talked about, wider sidewalks and bike facilities, will get people out of their cars? So we just made our best case for a more multimodal Laredo, a hard sell. What do you think? Is it possible? All right. So half the people are like, yes, this will work. 75% are yes, or maybe yes. And then there are other people who are not so sure, and another portion that we still have to win over. One of the last big ideas, the idea of planning new and improved public spaces. 17 out of 17 tables drew little plazas. They talked about links and trails along the creeks. They talked about park enhancements. They put stickers for trees and for bike lanes. We love the idea of reviving the square, right? The beautiful squares that Laredo is known for. Bringing them to neighborhoods instead of just the residual open spaces that are created as part of the subdivision process with the backs of buildings facing on. What about potentially adding more trees, adding gazebos, and potentially even making smaller spaces and letting, you know, attached houses and townhouses mix in? We were looking all around the city to figure out where we could put placitas of any kind and kids' areas. Or plazas that just two different restaurants. It could be a Whataburger and a Taco Valente. And they could be right next to each other. And they will form a plaza. This is all totally illegal and not allowed by the land development regulations. But you have a nice climate for most of the year. Sometimes it is very hot. But for most of the year, there should be umbrellas outside and people dining. We were trying to imagine the very smallest little outdoor spaces, these little forecourts, like you see in Nuevo Laredo, and adding more of that to the city. But not just the old squares that we used to have, where the kids would sort of court each other and sit on the benches and write poetry like they did for 200 years. Our squares are gonna have to have more. Dog park. Every fifth person that came in during this studio was like, where's my dog park? I need a dog park, right? People are nodding, hands are going up. So the new public spaces have to be a little more varied and interesting than the ones in the past. They have to be dog parks, spots where food trucks can pull up, Wi-Fi if possible, and because you have a hot sun, that wherever there are kids' areas, there needs to be shade for the kids. We've been looking at parks, at spaces like St. Peter's Square. So right now there's some nice trees and there's basketball. And that's great, but it's such a large square. And if we're thinking about people living downtown, so much could happen there. It could be the all-wheels park, the skate park, right? It could be the playground. It could be the basketball hoops could stay, but we could use them on the side to put in a central green, the dog park, a park pavilion with a fruiteria, ornamental fences, places to sit, places in the shade. A lot can be done with a small amount of space. If it's planned. The last of the big ideas was that we want to do all of this, but still make sure that everyone gets to stay. Young people continue to come back. No one is forced out. The place remains affordable, and actually could even become more affordable. The reality with city planning, if done well, is it isn't about gentrification and pushing people out. It is about, you know, decreasing poverty levels and increasing median wages and putting in jobs. But the well-designed city is a city that's easier and less expensive to live in. This is a long slide for this late in the project, and with a lot of words, but we've been talking about this and people have found it important. Laredo has the least number of bike commuters in the country. Laredo has nearly the lowest number of commuters who walk in the country. Laredo families pay 32% of household income in driving costs. Now, on a house that has with the right balance only pays 15%. So that means Laredans are paying twice as much for driving and for cars as households nationally. If the median household income here is $40,000 a year, that means about 13,000 of that is spent in cars. $13,000 is not spent on putting it away for college for the kids or putting it, you know, into a big trip, or putting it into all variety of things. Families decrease driving costs by adding biking and walking in other transit. We're seeking not for a less expensive, but for a more affordable Laredo. And it isn't just about like older middle-aged men in Lycra on $1,200 bikes. You know, this is not that kind of bike. In Laredo, biking is not just for recreation. In Laredo, biking is an essential way to get around. On Del Mar Boulevard, we're looking at spaces in between, you know, connecting streets and building neighborhoods that would attract the doctors and the nurses that you need, building neighborhoods that would attract the upper level executives that we could add to the tax base. There's so much I could say about the neighborhood designs we've done. I just let the words, let the image, the James Doherty, do the speaking for me. You can have brand new places like this once again, you know? He took inspiration from, do you recognize this building? Yeah, the tack room. He did a double story tack room. The church at the end of the street, because that's the tradition here, and it's a great one. And people outside and dining, and the architecture that isn't just glass and steel or concrete and reinforced concrete, but a more beautiful and civilized and humane place where the social, the very social people of Laredo can meet each other on the street. Now, we've heard, we're working with developers on these concepts. We're talking to all the major developers. We don't want this to be a plan that just sits on the shelf. We've heard that it's hard to build in Laredo. It is expensive to deliver a house for less than $120,000 for a lot of different reasons. The plan is working to make it easier to build. The more building, the more affordable. The more we can change the regulations, update the regulations, the more we can unlock the potential, and the quicker and more affordably we can deliver. I want you to know that this isn't just the planner's plan. We're working very closely with the people who build the city. I got one more big before and after to show you, okay? This idea has been talked about for a long time. This is the first plan that's actually going to make this city policy, should the city adopt it. This is a view of the Kansas City Southern Rail Yards. Do you know where that is? The Kansas City Southern Rail Yards, looked at in this image, is this big, huge rail area just east of Azteca on the Rio Grande. Right now, it's very important to keep this rail line because you're a trade city. But there are a lot of warehouses that aren't being used, and you have all these stacking yards. These trains used to have to do these formations in order to add cars that are no longer necessary. They have machines that do it, large machines, okay? This whole stacking yard could be consolidated. There's a water treatment plant on that Zacate Creek that they're looking at moving elsewhere. It needs to be updated. It's exceeded its design life. What if you take those 60 acres, which are right next to the downtown and right on the river, and you transform it? You could build an area about as large as the downtown. You could create the first very large sort of grand park of Laredo on that river. You could unlock... Other cities have done it. El Paso's doing it. Denver did it. Providence, Rhode Island, where I'm from, did it. Boston is doing it. Tucson is doing it. Rail cities are reclaiming lost land. This is a big idea that you've discussed for a long time. People have been looking at the rail yards. It's becoming technically, physically possible. What if? Now, let's talk about economic development, because economic development is the way we pay for this. Economic development is the way we create the jobs that support the tax base, that build the infrastructure, that plant the trees, and create the parks that we're talking about. And we're lucky to be working with one of the premier economists in the region. And he's running away. This is the last presenter, and then I'll let you know, the very last question we're going to ask you tonight is the plan headed in the right direction? Is the plan on track? Do you like the plan? And you're going to get a chance to tell us what you think about what we present. So stay with us. We are almost done. Thank you for your patience.
Thanks, Jason. I think in another 15 minutes, we're going to hear the librarian say, we have only 15 minutes to evacuate the building. I think that was done on purpose. We have 15 minutes to take a vote. How many of you think that this was possible? By show of hands, many of you. Well, this all happened because of you, of your participation. Comprehensive economic development plans cannot happen on their own. They cannot be accidents. They have to be the will of the people, of the community, and this is what you have done. I've been in economic development for 33 years, and I know when I see hardworking people, proud people, of proud of their heritage, proud of their culture, extremely creative people. Nobody comes close to the Latinos on that. How do I know? How do I know that? I married one. Well, let me say that I'm very proud to be part of this exceptional team of experts, from architectural planning to master planning to transportation expertise, as well as our firm, which is responsible for doing the economic development plan. I'm going to ask a few questions, if you don't mind. By a show of hands, how many of you lived here for less than 5 years? Just one of you. How many of you have lived here for more than 10 years? More than 20 years? Okay. Well, we need to do something about this. An economic development plan is all about changing the demographics of this region long term. We need to be sure that we have more new people moving into your city, increase your population, increase your workforce, bring in new businesses, bring more money into your community. In many respects, your community has stayed stagnant for the last 10 years or so. Your population has not moved according to even the US averages, which are by nature very, very low. So let me say that economic development is really three things. It's about attracting new businesses. It's about giving support to your existing businesses to expand. Some of them may leave, do you want to retain them? But the primary, I would say, the mother of all economic development is entrepreneurship. And I know of no other culture that is more entrepreneurial than the Hispanic culture. All across America, 30% of all new businesses are starting from Hispanics. And we often forget that some of the large businesses today, they were very small at some point in time. So we need to go back to show support for entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship needs to be part of the economic development plan. So what we intend to give you with this plan is a solid plan for economic growth. Economic growth that will be sustainable, and one that will encapsulate the vision of your community, your desires of how you want to build this city in the future. We're going to look at global trends, regional trends, and make sure that this strategy is not pie in the sky. It really reflects the wishes of the people, and it is implementable. We're going to show support for entrepreneurship, because I think that potential is huge for your community. What is economic development? Have you ever thought of how economic development can transform a community, your wealth, your cost of living, your well-being? Today, the total property valuation in your county is as such, where $50,000 is the valuation per employee from the businesses. When we look at the valuation,
closing in 15 minutes.
Yeah, I was hired to be the entertainment tonight, but I don't sing, I don't dance, so I'm sorry, but you're going to have to suffer with me on this. But when you look at the valuation on a per capita basis for residents, it's only $25,000. So how do we increase the wealth in this community? How do we lower taxes for all of your residents? We need to diversify your economy. We need to bring more businesses to be paying more taxes to be sure that you are on a sustainable path to growth. So we've looked at what types of industries can grow here. And we have, by the way, held over 120 interviews with one-on-one with individual key stakeholders, focus groups. We've done a survey for residents, and we had over 850 people take that survey. We've also surveyed about 150 of your businesses. So we look at what industries are concentrated locally. What are those clusters of industry doing nationally? Are there local assets and advantages that Laredo has that will allow it to be competitive in some of these industries, and which ones they are? And then do these industries meet the goals of the community? So looking at overall the target sectors, our analysis and your input has given us four targeted industries: healthcare, trade and advanced logistics, tourism and retail, and business and educational services. But that does not mean that the only businesses that we can grow in Laredo are these businesses. But if we have limited resources, if we want to focus them on growing certain sectors of the economy, these are the best sectors for Laredo. If we do a good job in these, other businesses will grow along with them as well. But I wanted to be sure that I just don't focus on the top line here. In fact, I don't care about the top line. This is what you've got. These are the core industries under each one of those major categories: home health services, specialized services. What we want to look at is the diversification targets and the emerging targets for your economy in the future. So we want to have more vocational training here. We want to look at elderly health services in your living. We want to look at outpatient care centers. Under trade and advanced logistics, we want to look at innovative technologies. There's no other community in the country that has as much logistics and trade as Laredo does. 22% of all NAFTA goes through the port here, of all NAFTA activity. 70% of all NAFTA activity coming through the state of Texas comes through this border. But that's all you have: logistics, warehouse, and real estate. You haven't really developed the technology aspect of logistics, and that's what we want to focus this plan on. On tourism and retail, we have to look at performing arts. You know, Hispanics have beautiful culture, beautiful arts. We spoke a lot about downtown. And let me tell you how I feel about your downtown. Downtown is like the living room to your community. Your living room is the best part of your home. That's where your visitors come. You invest in the most money in the furniture to make it look good. When I look at downtown Laredo, I'm sorry, I can see no investment that has been made over many, many years. It's been totally neglected. If a visitor comes to Laredo, it's not likely they're going to go in northeast Laredo. They're going to come through your 35 downtown, and if they see what I see, they're not going to be very impressed. So that is why a lot of the focus on this plan has been on your downtown. You improve your central business district, and your community is going to look different to all of you and all of the visitors that come through your city. Boutique hotels, destination retail, and we're seeing the beginning of that. Cultural and heritage tourism. Sports as a destination. You have certain activities that are going here that are terrific, and how can we promote them more? How can we make sure that Laredo is a place where it's a city that is very attractive for sports-related type of activities. We need to look at design services and shared services, not just have oil and gas services where the market is just going up and down. Computer programming. Mexico, in my view, is the sleeping giant of information technology and contracting work. All of that work has gone to India, Pakistan. A lot of it is now being developed in Mexico. How can we bring IT professionals here on the border and have them do contract work for major US corporations as well as from all around the world? So computer programming is an area where I think can be a substantial sector in which this economy can grow into. Aircraft maintenance and repair. You have an underutilized airport, and typically airports that are underutilized, you can attract a maintenance facility, you can attract painting facility, and so forth and so on. Great paying jobs for mechanics, averaging probably $65,000 per year. So, to walk you through the vision that we have for your community, is we're going to focus our strategy, our goals, in these four distinct areas: spur innovation in logistics, enrich quality of place, proactive economic development, and promote regional cooperation. I am an outsider, but at the same time, I want to tell you something that I believe firmly in it. The reason Laredo exists today is because of Nuevo Laredo. That's where the economic activity is, south of the border, that has made this city possible. But I'm concerned and alarmed by the way that I see the two cities kind of pulling apart. You cannot forget your past. You cannot forget Nuevo Laredo. You cannot just only go about what has happened in the last decade or so with violence and so forth and so on. You cannot give up on that heritage, on that culture, and quite frankly, your future. So I would like to see a much more integrated economic development strategy that incorporates both cities and the entire region. So economic development for this entire process is where the rubber meets the road. The visualization that we have seen presented to you tonight can all happen because of the economic development strategy. We want to make sure that the city makes the right and the county makes the right public investments. But economic development is all about the private sector contributing to this economy and making all these redevelopment projects possible in your downtown, in your major thoroughfares, and so forth and so on. So the definition of economic development in my book is how can we leverage your asset base, the parks, the educational facilities, your culture, and make sure that we are attracting more private sector dollars to come to your economy in each and every year. My friends, I know I'm the last speaker, and I'll leave you with a few thoughts. Economic development has never meant to be a sprint, it's a marathon. So I ask you, no matter what the difficulties may be, don't ever give up. Hispanics don't give up. I'm going to paraphrase the words of a famous president of ours who said, don't ask what economic development can do for each one of you, but rather what each one of you can do for your city's economic development and your future. That is what it's all about. If not now, tell me when. If not you, tell me who is going to implement this strategy, who is going to be behind its implementation. I would hope and urge each one of you today to follow this process. We're not finished yet. To be sure that you become the ambassadors of this project throughout the community, because a lot of the citizens have not been engaged, as one would expect. But we've engaged thousands of you, and I hope that each one of you can become the biggest supporter, the biggest pusher for this strategy to be implemented, because I do not like what happened to your last economic development strategy. It's sitting on a shelf. You spend money, and nothing has ever been done. So show your support to your elected officials. Show your support to the institutions in this community, and let's make it happen. What I will say to you tonight is, you've had a lot of economic development, but the best economic development is yet to come to Laredo. So, bring your city to life. Bring Laredo to life. Let's not make this a city boring. That word needs to exit from your vocabulary of describing Laredo today. Thank you so much.
So we drew the areas that you had picked on your maps. It was over 10 square miles of areas that we drew. If those areas, if this plan was implemented tomorrow, then the headlines in Laredo Morning Star would be, "New Laredans drive less, trips not involving car up from 6% to 18%. New, how Laredo rediscovered its downtown, 40% increase in residents in the downtown. Laredo spends more time in parks, 70% of residents now within a 10-minute walk of the park." Imagine seeing that in the paper. Other headlines. If we did this right, the headlines would be, "Laredo reduces time spent in traffic, Laredo paying less in utilities. Most importantly, more young Laredoans return after college or stay to start new businesses. And the challenge that we got from the city manager, Laredo ranks the most livable city in South Texas." Now, there's no overnight solutions in city planning. We've been talking to people, planners from other cities. The pretty pictures that we drew, that we showed tonight, they become reality. In El Paso, we drew a square that became the proudest public space. In El Paso, we drew a mall that was dying, and we turned it into a town, and that's a town that they're building. So I want you to know that this takes a while. It takes commitment, and everybody has to take a piece and make it work in order for this to happen. But this can happen. And a border town, favorite thing I heard in these last couple weeks, if planned, if everyone's committed, the right leadership and the right citizenry, a border town can be the best of both worlds. All right, last question. As promised, do you feel the plan is generally on the right track? One for yes, two for probably yes, three for can't tell yet, and four for no. Look how nervous Mario is. All right, look at that. Wow, 93% of people. This is another first. This is another first from a guy who does this all over the place. This is one of the highest votes of confidence we have had. This is great. Viva Laredo. Thank you very much for your time tonight.